people were confused, disillusioned, afraid. All of these emotions were spawning all kinds of music.
That was the year that disco exploded in New York.
Back in 77, we took hip-hop from the South Bronx, brought it into the club. We never thought it would blow up like it did.
Yeah, 1977 was a big year for punk rock.
There was a buzz at CBGB's. Everybody wanted to sign punk bands.
It was no coincidence that during this period of really kind of ultimate decay for New York, it was an incredibly exciting place to be.
I mean, it was deteriorating like at a rapid pace, man. I mean, so fast, whole areas was just wiped out, man.
Gangs really controlled areas, and a lot of times things would happen and the police wouldn't even show up.
The gangs gave kids this sense of cohesion in what was otherwise, for many of them, a completely chaotic world.
Most of the people's parents, they were struggling, they were broke. You know, they had two jobs or no job, or they were strung out themselves on drugs. So a lot of these kids were monitoring their own life. You know, they were going to high school and they were out, you know? They were on their own, basically. And the only positive thing we had was music.
Hip-hop, I believe, came about as a culture because there was a fairly substantial group of young people in African American and Latino communities that felt that there was nothing there for them. The public school system, because of the fiscal crisis at that time, had abandoned most music programs throughout the city. You know, you couldn't belong to a marching band in your high school if your high school didn't have one. You couldn't go to a rec center if you didn't have a rec center.
We didn't have something that really belonged to us. You know, everybody had their own movement, you know, and 77 was actually a breakout showcase year for hip hop. I went to a Bambada party and I was totally blown away. Something about seeing that music channeled out that way definitely appealed to me.
You would follow the vibration of the music and you would arrive at the block party. You would see some people doing graffiti writing on the wall live, and there would be people with cardboard boxes out doing b-boy. The center of the party would be the DJ. Yeah. Early on, of course, you had people like Hollywood and Chief Rocka Busy Bee and Love Bug Starsky, but Africa Bambaataa is the godfather of hip hop.
Come down, baby. Come to my island paradise.
I came out of the street gang movement that we had at the time, which was called the Black Spades. In my area of the Bronx River houses, we had a center where I used to play the music, and many of the youth start feeling the energy of these DJs, these breakers. So I went out there and started transforming the street gangs into something positive, and it was the culture called hip-hop.
He comes out of the gang culture, gets an epiphany, and begins to organize in his community.
Africa Bambaataa did an unbelievable job with, you know, getting all the youth and the gangs together to try to not be violent, to do it through music.
The party that he gave resonated throughout the neighborhood and then soon throughout the Bronx. From then on, that's all I wanted to do.
KRS actually took the initiative, you know what I mean, and told me, listen, man, you know, do this with me, you know what I mean? And once I got behind the turntables, it was something that was overwhelming, something that actually took over.
In 77, if you were a DJ, you had to have your own sound system. I don't mean like you just put your records on the arm and just, oh no. You had to have the speakers and the amplifiers and the turntables and everything, and you brought all that out to the park to play.
You know, we were kids, you know, we were teenagers, and you know, we really didn't have that kind of money.
I was lucky because I had a few dollars saved in the bank that my father had left me, and I had to convince my mother once I knew that this is what I wanted to do, hey Ma, I need that money. You know what I mean? I found what I want to do. I don't want to go buy sneakers with it. I don't want to go. I want to buy some DJ equipment. I want to be a DJ. We never would have had the ingenuity to plug our system up to a light pole, I don't think, if we was in Omaha. You understand what I'm saying? We wouldn't have had the resources at hand, the mindset to say, yo, that's an electric light, ain't it? Look in that pole, look in the bottom, man, and see if there's anything in there. You know what I mean? Just takes that kind of mindset and ingenuity to say, okay, let's find something to make this work. We didn't have those big industrial extension cords now. We had them little 9-6-foot, 9-foot extension cords. You had to plug one up to the other. And we had to buy like 15 or 20 of them and run them all the way from a pole all the way into the park. But that's what it took to keep the party going, so that's what we did.
No one was watching us. I mean, the police weren't coming to the parks and shutting our parties down. I mean, if you go to a park now and try to hotwire a street lamp into a party, you'll be shut down in 5 minutes. You know what I mean? I mean, they just were busy doing other things. You know what I mean? And thank God for that.
It's the same energy, that punk movement and the hip-hop movement uptown. Punk was the next generation rockers saying, you know, that's too tame or that's like our mom's music. And that's where the frenetic energy of punk came from. At the same time, we took the hottest parts out of records that already existed and kind of pumped them up. And you know what I mean? That adrenaline that created hip-hop up in the Bronx.
In 77, we went to this big rap show in the South Bronx. It was completely a new thing to me. There was no separation between the audience and the stage. Everybody was just, you know, running on stage and doing a few lines and jumping back into the crowd. It was just like so exciting. It was great.
And I was the first to invite the punk rockers, the white people, who wasn't nervous to come to a black Latino area and party with the people. Most people thought it was going to be chaos, racism, fights and everything. When we put that music on, the music took control and became universal, and everybody just party like we was partying on the mothership. 77 is when hip-hop started coming into its own. Because at that time, you used to have the DJs battles in the parks where both groups would play at the same time. And it'd be like a sound clash, and whoever had the loudest system would overrule.
In 77, you know, Wiz, he goes and he starts, sets up a battle against Bambaataa. Now, it wasn't me, because Wiz is always the one like, yo, let's go battle them, yo. Let's go get them. Let's go battle them.
Back in those days when you DJed, you know, there was a lot of player hate. There was a lot of animosity, you know what I mean? And they wanted to get at you, and they would talk a lot of trash. You know what I mean? There was a lot of trash talking back in those days. I mean, that's part of hip-hop, too. You know what I mean?
We come in there with the most equipment that we could find, piece together. You know what I mean? Odds and ends, speakers, you know, from here and there and everything. And we think we're ready. We go in there. So I have the nerve to put on We Will Rock You by Queen. So I put it on, and it comes on, and it's like, doo doo cha, doo doo cha, doo doo cha, doo doo cha. Audio rolling, making me noise, playing in the trees. You know what I mean? I'm here like Mr. Biggs, who was an MC for Bambaataa, got on the mic and bellowed, Casanova, turn up your system. We can't hear you. I'm like, okay, try to crank it up. Said, do do cha, do do cha, do do cha, do do cha. He's like, Casanova, we still can't hear you. This is what it sound like. Put on the same record. Boom boom cha, boom boom cha. Yo, we just like, okay, grab the wires, let's rip, you know what I mean? Let's start unplugging shit, like, yo, let's get out. Oh, my God. It was, that was like one of the most humiliating things. But it was another one of those life lessons, man. And another thing that we survived in 77. You know what I mean? That could another crew or another group, that would have been the end of them. You would have never heard of them again. They was done.
they would have been done. But I pop up like toast. Every neighborhood had its like neighborhood flavor. I mean, in the Bronx, in the summertime, you knew what was happening. The sprinklers was open, kids was playing, you know what I mean, in the street, basketball games and basketball tournaments and picnics and just like every other place, but it was in parks.
We did a lot of free parties, Echo Park, Arthur Park, 183rd Street Park.
One particular day, we were playing, myself and my DJ partner, Disco Wiz, out in the park in the Bronx.
Cass and I were challenged to a battle, to a street DJ battle. Just like any other day, we were at 183rd Street in the park between Valentine and Raya. So we kind of hotwired the street like we always did and got the juice, got the party going and everything.
So we come on, right? So we ready, you know what I mean? I put the turntable, got my records ready. I put the first record on, and I know that as soon as people hear this, they're going to go wild. So boom, energy is flowing. Record is going, right? I grab the next record. I bring it in. The lights start going out. The street lights along the street start going out. One at a time, like in a row. Poof, poof, poof.
We just looked at each other. Wow, did we do this? I mean, because we were jacked up to a street lamp, you know what I mean?
I was home, sitting here watching television. Bingo. All the lights go off, television goes off. I go up to the roof, look out. Darkness.
I'm 12 years old. I'm watching Bewitch on television. And the lights go out. I thought it was just us, because that's a common occurrence. I looked outside, and everything was black.